All of us have memorable days in our lives, ones we'll remember forever. I'd like to tell you about one such day in my life. It happened a long time ago, on September the 2nd, 1958. On that day, my best friend Neal Echols and I had a session with a legend, brushed up against fame and fortune, and stood in the presence of giants. All quite unrealized by us at the time, I might add. I know all of these things need explaining, so I'll start at the beginning. Back in the 1950s, I was in a band. Singer Neal Echols, along with Don Duke on drums, Linda Peterson on piano, and yours truly, were a pretty good little rock and roll band out of La Mesa, Texas. We called ourselves Neal Echols and the Raindrops. We played at sock hops, demolay dances, and school activities, just about anywhere we were invited. We were even featured on local television a few times. Just north of La Mesa, in the little town of Clovis, New Mexico, a man named Norman Petty had a small recording studio. Bands from all over Texas and New Mexico were recording there. There was a band out of Wink called Roy Orbison and the Teen Kings, a guy from Happy named Buddy Knox, a singer from Littlefield by the name of Waylon Jennings, and a trio from Lubbock called Buddy Holly and the Crickets. Why not a band from La Mesa, Neal and I asked each other. We had written a couple of songs we thought had potential, so on September the 2nd, 1958, we drove to Clovis and recorded both our songs that very night. We called them College Love and Hayride of Love, subjects we were both very interested in at the time. Petty's studio was certainly the place where giants did hang out. Buddy Knox had a couple of real good hits and a long career. Roy Orbison became an international star. Waylon Jennings had dozens and dozens of hits, and Buddy Holly, well, we all know that he became an absolute legend. Norman Petty himself was pretty well known in the area at the time because of his band, the Norman Petty Trio, but he would go down in history because of his work in his studio. The songs he recorded were so unique that Norman Petty Recording Studios was referred to as the Abbey Road of New Mexico. The sound he produced was so good that it was dubbed the Clovis Sound. Much of the music from his studio became known as rockabilly, a blend of country and western and rock and roll music, both highly popular in West Texas at the time. What you're hearing right now is a perfect example of rockabilly.
Oh boy, oh boy, when you're with me, oh boy, oh boy, the whole world can see that you were meant for me.
Alas, Neal Echols of the Raindrops didn't obtain fame and fortune like Buddy Holly and the Crickets. So you won't hear College Love or Hayride of Love on the radio like Oh Boy, Ravone, or Peggy Sue. But interestingly, on our songs, you can clearly hear a major reason why the Clovis sound was so good, and one of the main reasons why Norman Petty became a legend.
Now I know the thrill of college.
Does it sound like Mr. Petty has put less effort in arranging and producing College Love because it was less commercial than, say, Oh Boy? Absolutely not. If anything, he tried harder. This is an important element of the Clovis sound. Norman Petty was a perfectionist. He made sure that every song he produced was the best that it could be. On College Love, he even woke up his wife, Vi, in the middle of the night to come play the organ. He called in the Roses to back up the great voice of Neal Echols and added a bass player and a drummer to the session. You might recognize the Roses. They sang back up to Buddy Holly on most all of his early recordings. It took Mr. Petty all night to record our two songs. He made sure that they were as good as they could possibly be, regardless of the hour. With Norman Petty at the controls, every artist in his studio was important, whether it be Buddy Holly and the Crickets or Neal Echols and the Raindrops. Neal and I were truly in a session with a legend, but we just didn't know it at the time. Not only was Norman Petty a masterful record producer, he was also an exceptional engineer. He designed and installed all of the recording equipment in his control room. He chose all of the microphones and the musical instruments in his studio. He even chose the material on the studio wall and changed its shape constantly to change the acoustics. His studio was way ahead of its time, revolutionary actually. The result was this crystal clear sound that you hear right now. A very important element of the Clovis sound. Back in 1958, Neal and I certainly didn't expect that recording in Norman Petty's studio would be historic, but it was. It's a shame we weren't as talented as Buddy Holly, but that's okay. At least Neal and I did actually record in the Abbey Road of New Mexico. And in doing so, we got to work with a legend, Norman Petty. We brushed up against fame and fortune and were certainly in the presence of giants. It was a very memorable day in our lives, one that we have cherished ever since. Interestingly, Bill Greggs, a noted Buddy Holly historian, reported that Holly had copies of both College Love and Hayride of Love in his possession when he died. Why did Buddy Holly have our songs in his possession? Could he have been thinking about recording them himself? Boy, I really wish I knew, but unfortunately we'll never know, because as you know, the music died on February 3rd, 1959, in Clear Lake, Iowa, 5 months after our recording session. Fame and fortune lost forever. I'm Duane Whitlow.
Oh, the little things you say.